Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. Over the last few segments, we've been talking about the income statement, what it is, why it's important, and how to build the most common style, the multi-step income statement. We also talked about different styles under US GAAP and IFRS, and then we started talking about the unusual events or line items. There were four of them that we specifically mentioned. We talked a little bit about the unusual ones, but we've done that before and we'll do a lot of them later. So we said we'd focus on the other four: a change in estimate, a change in principal, a change in entity with a discontinued operation, and finally, an extraordinary item. All of these affect our income statement and what our investors see, so we need to practice a little bit with them and how we record them. Specifically, last time, we got started with a change in estimate. It was the only one we had time to really look at. If you remember, a change in estimate is treated like a new transaction moving forward. We don't go back and change any of the old information or the old estimates we've made. We just take what we've done so far and use that as a basis to move forward with the new numbers. And we started doing it with this example right here. Now for this example, we changed the depreciation estimate. Instead of a 4-year total useful life with a $2,000 salvage value, it now has a 7-year estimated useful life with a $500 salvage value. Now the company had already depreciated for 2 years, but we didn't go back and change that. We just used that information moving forward to come up with journal entries and calculations that look like these. So you remember up here at the top, we figured out that we'd recorded already $4,000 of accumulated depreciation. We took that out. It's been depreciated. We don't have to worry about it anymore. And said there's $6,000 left that need to be depreciated. Now, 7 years total, 2 years gone, we have 5 years of useful life left. And we think we'll be able to sell it for $500. So we came up with a new estimate for what depreciation should be for this year and the four remaining years, and that's this number in yellow, $1,100. And then we made our journal entries. What we had done already, what we wish we had done, and how to get from what we did do to what we should have done. What we missed was, what does this do to the income statement? So let's take a look now at what this will do to our income statement. And to do that, we need an income statement. Well, later on, we're going to want that original set of numbers. So if you scroll over to your right a little bit, starting in column M, I have created a new version of this income statement that we can use to tweak for our examples. I'm going to highlight several rows here, all the way down to row 98. And I'm going to make this blue. So what we basically said was that we needed to change depreciation expense. We've depreciated too much and we need to drop it now. So if we come down to our administrative expenses, there's depreciation expense, $40,000. And what we're going to do is we're going to drop that by the 900. And you can type it in or you can link it, either way works. The key idea though is that we're going to drop that depreciation expense. Hopefully you notice as you hit enter what changed. Depreciation expense changed, which changed our total administrative expenses and our total S&A expenses and our total income from operations, income from continuing operations, and net income. It flowed all the way through. It also changed our income tax expense, which we didn't do a journal entry for, but it's something that changes, right? If our profit changes, then so do the taxes that we owe on that net income. So anytime our net income changes, there's going to be a tax effect as well. Usually with a journal entry, but you can't have all the fun in one example. That wraps up this first change, a change in estimate. And again, the important idea here is that when we change an estimate, we just move forward with the new numbers. And I know I've said that several times, but it's really important that you remember this is how FASB says that we do these. Now let's take a look at the next kind of special item. And that's a change in principal. Now, a change in principal really means that we've changed methods. So, for example, we were doing LIFO for our inventory. We've switched to FIFO. We were doing straight-line depreciation. Now we've switched to double declining balance. We were doing a percent of sale for our bad debt expense. Now we're going to use percent of accounts receivable. Could be any of these different changes. So, here's our example. If you read through this, you can see they had accounts receivable of $108,000, allowance for bad debts of $50,000. They wrote off $67,500 in unpaid accounts. That means they're never going to get paid, so they wrote down accounts receivable and they wrote down their allowance that they'd set aside for people to rip them off. Now on December 31st, they had recognized $27,500 in bad debt expense, 2% of their credit sales. Now the company thinks, you know, credit sales is not a good estimate. We're going to change to 10% of accounts receivable as our estimate for who's going to rip us off. So instead of using total credit sales, it's the people that still owe us money when the year ends. Well, that makes sense. It's probably a better estimate. Is this a change in principle? It is. I've changed from one method, percent of sales, to the other, percent of accounts receivable. And technically, the rule with a change in method is you go back and you redo your financial statements as if you'd use this new method all year long. And if you're reporting this year's numbers and last year's numbers, or even 2 years' worth of historical numbers, you change everything using that new method so that your investors looking at these 3 years or 2 years of data can say, oh, that's what it looks like under the new method. That's the formal rule. But FASB carved a couple of exceptions out. They said, you know, there are some things where both the method and the numbers are all estimates, and we want you to treat all of those like a change in estimate. On the one hand, that makes things a little less accurate, and it makes it harder for investors if you've changed methods on one of these shortcut examples. It makes it harder for you because you can't compare last year's numbers to this year's numbers. On the flip side, from an accounting perspective, it's actually much easier. Going back through and re-estimating everything for the last 3 years and coming up with new numbers, that can be a challenging event in your accounting life. So it is kind of hard to do. Of all the topics we're going to cover, really the only thing that would be formally treated as a change in principle would be moving inventory methods from LIFO to FIFO or FIFO to weighted average, etc. In this case, we have a change in principle, but it's a change in principle that is treated like a change in estimate. And since we kind of need more practice with that idea, we're going to go ahead and show you how this change in principle would be shown in the income statement given how FASB wants it treated. So let's go back then to our income statement. And you can see over here, starting in row 85, I put the basic journal entries so that we could jump right into this. So our original entry, the number was given to us. It's in our income statement, and it's in the slide that we just looked at. So we showed bad debt expense of $27,500. Now we want to figure it out using this new method. And to do that, we get to use a T account. So the first thing we need to know is what the allowance for bad debts number was at the end of last year, the beginning of this year. Next, we need to know how much did we write off during the current period. And we know that because we were told you wrote off or used up $67,500 worth of your allowance for bad debt, more than we'd even set aside. This is why they had to change methods. Next, right here, down at the bottom, we're going to put in our desired ending balance. That's how the percent of accounts receivable method works. What you do is you take the accounts receivable ending balance times that 10% and say, that's what I want in my allowance. So if we go back to our raw data tab, we can see that our accounts receivable at the end of year two was $180,000. So that's the number that I want to use for this calculation. So back on my income statement, right here I'm going to put in $180,000. And I think that 10% of that is never going to be collected. So I want a total of $18,000 in my allowance for bad debt account. Well, now I can calculate it out. I can figure out what this number needs to be so that I can get that ending balance. So the way I'm going to do it is I'm going to take this number plus this number minus that number. And that's going to give me my answer. Now, for those of you who aren't as into T accounts, let's run through this using an equation. I'm going to hit enter. There's our number. That's what we're looking for right here. So remember, our equation is we take our beginning balance plus whatever we add minus what we take out or subtract, and that's going to equal our ending balance. So in this case, our beginning balance was $50,000. What we want to add is our bad debt expense, and that's what we're looking for. So I don't know that one yet. I'm going to subtract this, the $67,500 that I used up, and my ending is that $18,000. This is that 10% of accounts receivable. So now I can solve, right? This becomes bad debt expense is equal to the $18,000 plus the $67,500 minus the $50,000. And if you solve that out, you get the same $35,500. Now you've seen it both ways. We've done the T account and we've done the equation. Isn't this fun? I love this kind of stuff. Because now we get to do a journal entry, which is even better. So if I had used this correct method, or this new method, I should say, I would have reported $35,500 in my bad debt expense. But I didn't. I reported only $27,500. So I need to put more into bad debt expense. So to do that, I need to make that number bigger. And since it's expense, a debit makes it bigger. So I'm going to take 35.5 minus the 27.5, and I need an adjustment for $8,000. $8,000 to bad debt expense and to my allowance for bad debt. And if I add in what I had already, the 27.5 plus the 8,000, I'll get to that 35. So again, this is a correcting entry for change in principal, new bad debt expense method. Oh, and we'll make that italics. Remember, you never leave a real journal entry naked. Up here, we're just working on it. Not a real journal entry. But this would actually go in my journal. So it's got to have a description. Never leave it naked. To wrap up this discussion, we need to put that into our new income statement. So let's scroll over here. And my bad debt expense is here in 076, or oh, yeah, 076. And I'm going to add $8,000. And there's the 35.5, which is the number that I wanted. And again, you can see total selling has changed, total selling and administrative has changed, income from operations changes, and so do these numbers as well to show the new value. All right, that wraps up our examples of what goes above the line. Changes in estimate, changes in principal, and of course the unusual items that we've already talked about. What we need to talk about next are what do we do with discontinued operations and extraordinary items that appear below the line? How do they look on our income statement? And that's where we're headed when we come back. I'll see you then.